बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम, कैसे हैं आप? दिस इज लेक्चर नंबर 31, लेट्स स्टार्ट। फर्स्ट वी टेक अ रिव्यू ऑफ लास्ट लेक्चर। इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी डिस्कस्ड कॉमन मिसकंसेप्शंस अबाउट कोरिलेशन एंड हाउ पीपल यूज रॉन्ग वैल्यू ऑफ कोरिलेशन इन डिफरेंट सिचुएशंस टू डिसीव अदर इंडिविजुअल्स आर लेमेन। So then we discussed some related examples related to common confusions regarding correlation, and in the later half of last lecture we discussed regression analysis. So we introduced the regression analysis, and then we differentiated between regression and correlation, and in the end we discussed two types of regression models. One is simple regression model, another is multiple regression model. So let us discuss the objectives of the current lecture. So in this lecture, our main focus will be on simple linear regression model, and we will also develop the history or details of method of ordinary least squares. So this method is mostly used to estimate parameters of simple linear regression model as well as multiple linear regression model. So, but as far as this lecture is concerned, our focus is on simple linear regression model. So we will introduce you to the method of OLS, which is ordinary least square, and then we will also discuss some properties of OLS method. And in addition, we will discuss two very important concepts which are related to this regression as a model, that are the standard error of regression and the coefficient of determination. In the end, we will try to explain the regression analysis with the help of one simple example. So let's start. So we start with a simple linear regression model. So general form of a simple linear regression model is yt is equal to alpha plus beta xt plus ut, where t ranges from 1 to n. So where yi's are observations on dependent variable y, xi's are observations on independent variable x, alpha and beta are regression coefficients, are parameters, with alpha and beta are respectively the alpha is intercept and beta is slope of regression line, and they can be positive or negative depending upon the direction of relationship between x and y, and ui's are the errors. So here you can see that this y is related with x, so usually it is called y is a function of x. So now here this functional form is assumed to be linear, that is it is alpha plus beta x. So y is linearly related with x, and we have plus u as well. So note that here power or exponent of alpha is 1, power of beta is also 1. So this word linear mean linear in parameters. So linear in parameters. So in this regression model you can see that y is linearly related with x because power of alpha and beta is 1. So whereas in case of simple mathematical equations, so linear equation is if we have x raised to power 1. So y is linearly related with x. So here we have x raised to power 1, so y is linearly related with x, and this equation is called linear in variables because x raised to power 1, as well as linear in parameters because both alpha and beta they are raised to power 1. So this is called linear regression model. And further note that since we have only one explanatory variable, which is x here, so that's why it is called a simple linear regression model. So if instead of x we have x1, x2, x3, so then in that case it will be called multiple linear regression model. So another example, let us take another example. Suppose we have y is equal to beta x square plus u. So now you can see that still alpha and beta, they have their exponents, both have exponent as 1. So it means this is again another example of a linear regression model. Even though the variable x appears in square term, square form, so squared units, so but this variable is, this regression model is linear in parameters because alpha raised to power 1 as well as beta raised to power 1. So linear regression model mean linear in parameters. It can be non-linear in variables. So here the relationship between y and x is, here we have x square, so it is non-linear. But in the linear regression model mean the linear in parameters. So this is one very important point that should be noted. So simple linear regression model, an intuitive explanation. Suppose that a researcher has some idea that there should be a relationship between two variables y and x. In addition, theory suggests that an increase in x will lead to an increase in y. So a sensible first stage to testing whether there is indeed an association between the variables would be to form a scatter plot of them. So just construct a scatter plot of x and y. So here is the scatter plot of x and y. So suppose this is the outcome of scatter plot. I am just assuming a hypothetical number. So note that we see a positive linear relationship between x and y, which is obvious from this scatter plot. So both are showing an upward trend and slope is positive, so it is showing us a positive relationship between x and y, which means that increase in x are usually accompanied by increase in y, and that the relationship between them can be described approximately by a straight line. So we can represent the relationship between y and x by a straight line. It would be possible to draw by hand onto the graph a line that appears to fit the data. Let me draw a line. So here is the line. So the intercept and slope of line fitted by I could then be measured from the graph. So the line, the straight line where it cuts this y-axis, this is called intercept or alpha. And we can measure the slope, which is rise over run. So just take two points on this line. So suppose first point here, this one second point. So just measure this distance, the horizontal distance, and measure this distance, the vertical distance. So this is called run, this one is rise. So you can find this distance by tracing the point on y-axis. So suppose here this point is around 15 and this point is, let's say, 40. So this is, suppose, x1, this is x2. Similarly here, this point is 60, y1, and suppose it is 90, y2. So rise will be the difference of these two points, 90 minus 60, so y2 minus y1, or 90 minus 60, it is 30. And run will be distance between x1 and x2 from 15 to 40, or x2 minus x1, so which is 40 minus 15, and you get 25. So if we divide this vertical distance, which is called rise, and by this horizontal distance, which is run, we get slope, which is beta. So 30 over 25, 6 by 5, or you can simplify it, it is 1.2. So intercept is 40 and slope is 1.2. So you can say that this line is actually y is equal to alpha plus beta x. So alpha is 40 plus beta 1.2x. So the relationship between y and x is measured by this way. However, in practice, such a method is likely to be inaccurate because there are a number of possible lines. So another person can draw a line somewhat here. So a number of possible lines can be drawn. It would therefore be of interest to determine to what extent this relationship can be described by an equation that can be estimated using a defined procedure. It is possible to use the general equation for a straight line, which is y is equal to alpha plus beta x, where alpha is the intercept and beta is the slope, to get the line that best fits the data. The researcher would then be seeking to find the values of the parameters or coefficients that are alpha and beta, which would place the line as close as possible to all the data points taken together. So we need to fit a line that best explains this data. So actually you can see that as far as this hypothetical data is concerned, we have 9 data points. So 9 values of x and 9 values of y. So we have 9 pair of points. So instead of looking at the behavior of these 9 points, we just explain these 9 points with the help of straight line, and we need only these 2 points. One is the intercept and second one is the slope. So with the help of these 2 points, we can explain the behavior of these 9 points by drawing a straight line. And suppose if instead of these 9 points, 9 pair of points, suppose we have hundreds of observations. So suppose we have data on 100 individuals, both on x and y values. So even in that case, we can represent the data with the help of straight line, and we need only these 2 numbers, alpha and beta, which are intercept and slope. So with the help of only these 2 points, we can explain the behavior of 100 pair of points. So this is the basic advantage of constructing a regression model or drawing a straight line. So with the help of straight line, we can explain the behavior of 100 or maybe in some cases thousands of points with the help of only 2 numbers, which are the intercept and slope. There is another number, which is the variance of error term, variance of u, that is also important. So we will consider that point later. So currently you should be focused on that. With the help of these 2 points, we can explain the behavior of a large number of points. So note that the equation y is equal to alpha plus beta x is an exact equation, that if we know the value of x with given values of alpha and beta, we can exactly tell what y is. So it means it shows us an exact relationship between y and x. Assuming that this equation is appropriate, if the values of alpha and beta had been calculated, so then given value of x, it would be possible to determine with certainty what the value of y would be. So imagine a model which says with complete certainty what the value of one variable will be given any value of the other variable. So clearly this model is not the realistic. So statistically, it would correspond to the case where the model fitted the data perfectly, that knowing the value of x, we can tell the value of y exactly. So it means this model fits the data perfectly. That is, all of the data points, they lay exactly on a straight line. To make the model more realistic, a disturbance term denoted by u is added to the equation. So thus the equation becomes yd is equal to alpha plus beta xt plus this disturbance term is added. Where the subscript t ranges from 1, 2, 3 up to n, it denotes the observation number. When t is 1, we have the first observation of y So y1 is equal to alpha plus beta x1 plus u1, the first error term or first disturbance term. Similarly, when t is 2, we have the second value of dependent variable y2, which is related with x2, linearly related with x2, and plus u2, the second error term or the disturbance term. And similarly, when t is equal to n, so we have the nth value of y, which is linearly related with nth value of x plus the nth value of disturbance term. So question is, why we added the error term? So there are a number of reasons which are that why we added an error term. So, or in other words, why an error term exists in a regression model. So before moving further, let us discuss why an error term exists. So because the relationship between y and x is not exact, so in order to capture in order to get the exact relationship between y and x, we need to add this error term. In other words, the disturbance term or error term, it takes into account the effect of all those variables which we have not included in this regression model, and all those variables, they affect this variable y. So suppose y is affected by this variable x and some other variable w. So but since we have not included w, so the effect of that w, the missing variable, that will go to error term. So that's why the relationship between y and x will not be an exact, so we need to add an error term in order to incorporate the relationship of the missing variables. So let us formally discuss the reasons that why an error term exists in a regression model. So first point is that vagueness of theory. Sometime theory suggests that variable y is affected by some variable x. So, and suppose theory is not appropriate. So actually, y, which is dependent variable, is affected by suppose x2 and x3. So two independent variables are affecting one dependent variable y. But according to theory, only x2 matters in explaining y. So it means theory suggests that we should only include x2 variable. So we should not consider x3 variable. So since the theory is not proper, or it is not accurate, or it is a vague theory, so due to missing variable, since we have not included x3 in the regression model, so that's why the effect of this missing variable x3, it will appear in the form of an error term. So if we predict the relationship between y and x1, so suppose here we have alpha plus beta x1 plus let's say beta 1 x1, beta 2 x2 plus u. So if theory suggests that we should exclude this variable, so the effect of this variable will go to error term. So that's why error term will exist in the regression model. Another reasons that an error term may appear in the regression model is unavailability of data. Suppose y is related with y is affected with x1 and x2. So but the data on x2 is not available. So it means we cannot include this x2 in the regression model due to unavailability of data on this particular variable. So we need to construct a regression model without considering this model, this variable x2. So since we are not considering this variable, which is actually important in determining y, so the effect of this missing variable will go to error term. So an error term will exist, error term will occur in the regression model. So this will incorporate the effect of this missing variable. Next reason is core versus peripheral variables. So sometimes this y variable, it is, let's say, function of or affected by some variables x1, x2, x3 and suppose x4. But suppose only the first two variables are main variables are important variables which are comparatively more related with this variable y, which is dependent variable. But as far as the rest of the two variables are concerned, x3 and x4, they are also important in explaining y, but they are not as much important as the first two variables x1 and x2 are. So these variables, they x1 and x2, they are called the core or main variables, whereas the x3 and x4, they are called the peripherals or the additional variables. So if we do not include these peripheral variables x3 and x4 and we construct regression model by considering only x1 and x2, then the effect of these two missing variables x3 and x4, that will go to the error term, and error term will occur in the regression model. So that's why in order to incorporate these missing variables, we usually add an error term in the regression model. So this error term is added. So another case is the poor proxy variables. So sometimes we don't have the data. Suppose y is affected by variable x, but unfortunately or due to some issues, we don't have the data on this variable x. So in order to estimate this regression, we replace this x by some variable, suppose z. So and we estimate a relationship between y and z, where actual relationship should be between y and x. But since the data on x variable is not available, so usually a variable x, this variable x is replaced by another variable z, which is closely related to this variable x. But in some cases, if z is not as not much related with variable x, so then by estimating this regression model, y on z instead of y on x will not give us true picture, and we need to add an error term. So this, using this variable z instead of x, this is called, we are using z as a proxy mean in place of variable x. So if z is not a good proxy of this variable x, then estimating regression of y on z will give us not proper result, and we need to add an error term, or an error term will occur in order to incorporate the missing effect. And next one is the wrong functional form. Suppose the relation between y and x is non-linear. Suppose the relationship between y and x is y is equal to a plus b x square. But we estimated this relationship by a linear one. So it means plus u. So it means if the relationship is non-linear, but we are using linear relationship, so in that case, this will not capture the true picture. So that's why an error term will occur in order to capture the effect of all the missing variation. And last one is intrinsic randomness in human behavior. So usually human behavior is unpredictable. So if we try to incorporate certain variables, so due to randomness in human behavior, the relationship becomes inexact, and there will be an error term in the regression model. So these are some of the important situations. These are some of the important reasons that why an error term exists in a regression model. So question arises, how are the appropriate values of alpha and beta determined? So alpha and beta are chosen so that the vertical distances from the data points to the fitted lines are minimized, so that the line fits the data as closely as possible. So here is the line. So it is selected that this vertical distance is minimized. So here is the vertical distance. So the parameters are thus chosen to minimize collectively the vertical distance from the data point to the fitted line. This could be done by eyeballing the data, and for each set of variable y and x, one could form a scatter plot and draw a line that looks as if it fits the data very well by hand. So question arises, how are the appropriate values of alpha and beta determined? Alpha and beta are chosen so that the vertical distances from the data points to the fitted lines are minimized, so that the line fits the data as closely as possible. So the vertical distance means the distance between point and the line. So these are the vertical distances. The parameters are thus chosen to minimize collectively the vertical distances from the data points to the fitted line. This could be done by eyeballing the data, and for each set of variables y and x, one could form a scatter plot, which is shown here, and draw on a line that looks as if it fits the data well by hand. Note that the vertical distances are usually minimized rather than the horizontal distances, are those taken perpendicular to the line. This arises as a result of the assumption that x is fixed. So since x is fixed, so that the problem becomes one of determining the appropriate model for y, given that are conditional upon the observed value of x. This eyeballing procedure may be acceptable if only indicative results are required. But of course, this method, as well as being tedious, is likely to be imprecise. The most common method used to fit a line to the data is known as ordinary least square. This approach forms the workhorse. This approach forms the workhorse of statistical and econometric model estimation. Suppose now, for ease of exposition, that the sample of data contains only 5 observations. So here we have 5 data points, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. The method of OLS entails taking each vertical distance from the point to the line. So this vertical distance from point to line, so this distance, the second distance, vertical distance, the third one, the fourth one, and the fifth one. Then squaring each one, so square this distance, and then minimizing the total sum of squares. So hence this the name least squares. So we need to take the distance, and then we square each distance, and then we add up each of the square distance, so sum of the squares. So that's why we have to minimize this total sum of squares. So that's why it is called the least squares. So least mean minimize. This can be viewed as equivalent to minimizing the sum of the areas of the squares drawn from the points to the line. So we need to minimize the area of the squares. Tightening up the notation, let yt denote the actual data point for observation t, and y hat t denote the fitted value from the regression line. In other words, for the given value of x of this observation t, that is, for a given x t, y hat t is the value of y which the model would have predicted. So this is the predicted value, whereas the actual value is y t. So y hat is the predicted value. So this gap, the gap between this or this vertical distance, it is denoted by u hat t. So note that a hat over a variable or parameter is used to denote a value estimated by a model. So y hat means the estimated value of y from the regression model or this regression line. Finally, this u hat t denote the residuals, which is the difference between the actual value of y and the value fitted by the model for the data point. So u hat is actually yt minus y hat t. So this is shown for just one observation t in this diagram. So similarly, if we have, suppose, another data point which is corresponding to some other value of x, so this is another value of yt, and corresponding to this we have here y hat. So this distance is the error term, or ut. So if it is, let's say, the fifth value, so this y is the y5, this is y5 hat, and this is the fifth error term, and this is actually measured by the distance between y and y hat. So y5 minus y hat 5. So ut is yt minus y hat t. What is done is to minimize the sum of u hat t square. So we need to minimize the sum of squared residuals. The reason that the sum of squared distance is minimized rather than, for example, finding the sum of u hat t that is as close to zero as possible is that in the later case, some points will lie above the line while others lie below it. So then when the sum to be made as close to zero as possible is formed, the points above the line would count as positive values, whereas the point below would count as negatives. So these distances will in large part cancel each other out, which would mean that one could fit virtually any line to the data so long as the sum of the distances of the points above the line and the sum of the distances of the point below the line were the same. So positive values will affect negative values. So in that case, there would not be a unique solution for the estimated regression line. In fact, any fitted value that goes through the mean of the observations, that is x bar the mean of x and y bar the mean of y, would set the sum of ut to zero. So that's why by simply minimizing sum of ut, u hat t is not a good idea. So however, taking the square distances ensures that all deviations that enter the calculations are positive due to square, and therefore they do not cancel each other. So minimizing the sum of squared distances is given by so we need to minimize u1 hat square, u2 hat square, so up to so on u5 hat square. So we need to minimize the sum of squared residuals, or we can write it as minimizing summation u hat t square, where t ranges from 1 to 5, because this sum varies from 1 to 5. So where u hat t is y minus y hat t. So this sum is known as residual sum of square, and it is denoted by RSS. So R for residual and SS for sum of squares, or sum of squared residuals. So minimizing summation u hat t square is equivalent to minimizing a summation yt minus y hat t square. Why? Because u hat t is y minus y hat t. So just replacing the value of u hat t here, so minimizing summation u hat t square is same as minimizing summation yt minus y hat t square. So letting alpha hat and beta hat denote the values of alpha and beta respectively. So these are the estimated values, and these are selected by minimizing the RSS, which is summation u hat t square, and it is equal to summation yt minus y hat t square. So then the equation for the fitted line is given by y hat is equal to alpha hat plus beta hat times xt, where alpha hat and beta hat, they denote the values of alpha and beta which are obtained by minimizing RSS. So minimizing RSS is, so just replacing this y hat by this value, alpha hat plus beta hat xt. So it is y hat minus this value. So y hat minus alpha hat minus beta hat xt. So if we minimize this RSS with respect to alpha hat and beta hat to find the values of alpha and beta, which minimizes the residual sum of squares to give the line that is closest to the data. So for this, RSS is differentiated with respect to alpha hat and beta hat, setting the first derivatives to 0 and solving the resultant equations, we get least square estimates of alpha and beta as alpha hat and beta hat. So alpha hat and beta hat are given by, so beta hat is summation xt minus xt x bar into yt minus y bar divided by summation xt minus x bar whole square. And remember that if we divide both numerator and denominator by n, so this is the covariance between x and y, and this is sample covariance between x, y, and denominator is sample variance. So, but this 1 over n cancels with 1 over n, so this is the simplified form of beta. And similarly, alpha hat is equal to y bar minus beta hat x bar. So an alternative formula for finding alpha hat and beta hat is, so beta hat is n summation xy minus summation x summation y divided by n summation x square minus summation x whole square. And alpha hat is given by, it is equal to summation x square into summation y minus summation x y whole over n summation x square minus summation x whole square. Note that the denominator in both alpha hat and beta hat is same. So the difference occurs only in the numerator. So if we plug in these values of alpha hat and beta hat in this fitted regression model, so y hat is equal to alpha hat plus beta hat times x, where alpha hat is given by this formula or this alternative version. Similarly, beta has also two versions of the has can be represented by any of these two formulas. So let us discuss the properties of least squares line. The least squares regression line always goes through the point x bar y bar, that is the means of the data. So x bar is the mean of x values, y bar is the mean of y values. The sum of deviations of the observed values of yi from the least square regression line is always equal to 0. That is, summation y minus y hat is 0. So the sum of squares of deviations of the observed values of y from the least square regression line is a minimum. So symbolically, y minus y hat t square, so sum of square deviation is minimum. So next we discuss one important concept, that is the standard error of regression. The observed values of xy do not all fall on the regression line, but they scatter around it. Some of the values they lie above the regression line, some of the values lie below the regression line. So the degree of scatter or dispersion of the observed values about the regression line is measured by what is called the standard error of regression, or it is also called standard error of estimate of y on x. So estimate of y on x mean estimated error in the estimated value of y, a regression of y on x, where y is dependent variable and x is independent variable. So for population data, standard error of regression measures the variation of observations about the true regression line, which is expected value of y given x, and it is equal to alpha plus beta x, and it is given by sigma y dot x, it is equal to summation yt minus alpha minus beta xt whole square divided by n, where alpha and beta are called the true parameters of this regression model, are also called population parameters, and n is the population size. For sample data, we estimate this SER by SY dot x, and it is given by SY dot x is equal to RSS, which is residual sum of square, divided by n minus 2 whole square root. And note that since we have our regression model is alpha plus beta xt plus epsilon, so since we have two parameters, so that's why we have to subtract 2 from n, where small n is the sample size. And remember that this RSS is residual sum of square, so it is summation ut square, where ut is y minus y hat t. So that's why this RSS is summation y minus y hat t square. Now y hat t is, if we estimate, so y hat t is alpha hat plus beta hat xt. So just replacing the value of y hat here, so due to this negative sign, we get minus alpha hat minus beta hat times xt whole square, and whole divided by n minus 2 whole square root. So if we simplify it by opening the squares and taking summation, so this simplifies to s y dot x is equal to summation y minus alpha hat summation y minus beta hat summation x y whole over n minus 2 whole square root. So next we discuss another very important concept, that is the concept of coefficient of determination. It is also called R square. The variability among the values of dependent variable y, called the total variation, it is measured by total sum of squares, or TSS, total sum of squares. So the variability is given by TSS is summation y minus y bar whole square. So it means just taking the deviation of each value of y around its mean value. So this is called the total variation, or total sum of square. So note that total variation is composed of two parts. First one is called the explained variation. Second one is called the unexplained variation. So the variation which is explained by or associated with the regression line is called explained variation, and it is measured by explained sum of square and denoted by ESS, explained sum of square. And it is given by ESS is summation y hat minus y bar whole square. And the variation which the regression line fails to explain is called unexplained variation, and it is measured by residual sum of square, which is denoted by RSS, and it is equal to summation y minus y hat whole square. So this total variation, summation y t minus y bar t, that is how y is dispersed around its mean value, this can be splitted into two parts. One is explained variation, which is explained by the regression model, and second is the unexplained variation, which our regression model fails to explain. So explained variation is denoted by ESS, and it is obtained by this formula, summation y hat minus y bar whole square, whereas the unexplained variation is called RSS, and it is obtained by this formula, y summation y minus y hat whole square. So symbolically, we can represent that total variation is equal to explained variation plus unexplained variation, or TSS, which is total sum of square, it is equal to explained sum of square plus residual sum of square, and where TSS is y minus y summation y minus y bar whole square, ESS is summation y hat minus y bar whole square, and RSS is summation y minus y hat whole square. Coefficient of determination, which is also called R square, it measures the proportion of variability in the values of dependent variable y explained by its linear relation with the independent variable x. So it is defined by the ratio of explained variation to the total variation. So how much of the total variation is explained by this variable x, So how much of the total variation in y is explained by this variable x? So symbolically r square is, it is defined as, it is equal to ESS, which is explained sum of square divided by total sum of square, and it is equal to ESS is summation y hat minus y bar whole square divided by TSS is summation y minus y bar whole square. So r square ranges from 0 to 1. So r square can be 0, it can be 1, or it can take any value between 0 and 1. So interpretations, a value of r square close to 1 indicates that regression line fits the data very well. And a value of r square close to 0 indicates that regression line fits the data very poorly. A value of r square close to 0.5 indicates that regression line fits the data moderately. So here is our scatter plot. So if line fits the data very well, then r square will be close to 1. And suppose we have this plot. Suppose here is the regression line. So you can see that this regression line is not fitting the data well. So in this case, r square will be close to 0. So, but, so if r square, it fits the data, but the data is comparatively, relatively dispersed around this line, then r square will be around 50%. So suppose r square is 0.93 or 93%. So what will be its interpretation? So a value of r square equals to 0.93 or 93% means that 93% of the variability independent variable y is explained by its linear relationship with the independent variable x, and the remaining 7% of the variation is due to the chance or other factors. So let us explain the idea of regression with the help of an example. So given the data on x and y, so here is the data on x and y, so compute least square regression equation of y on x. That is, we need to calculate y hat, which is alpha hat plus beta hat x. So let us do it in Excel. So here is the same data on y and x, and the estimated line is y hat is equal to alpha hat plus beta hat x. So we need to calculate alpha hat and beta hat. So the value of alpha hat is summation x square into summation y minus summation x into summation xy divided by n summation x square minus summation x whole square. And similarly, we have the value of beta hat as well. So I'm going to calculate value of alpha hat and beta hat using these two formulas, and then I will plug in these two values of alpha hat and beta hat in this equations to get the fitted regression model. So note that in order to calculate alpha hat and beta hat, we need summation x, summation x square, summation xy. So it means we need to construct these two columns. First one is x square, second one is xy. So in order to calculate x square, we need to take square of this x. So just put an equal sign and then take square of this x value. So it is b2 square, and then copy it down. And similarly, in order to find the product xy, so just multiply x with y. So b2 times c2, copy it down as well. So once you have calculated all these values, so take the sum of all these columns. So sum of b2 to b10. So this will calculate sum of x values. So it is actually summation x. So copy it down rightward. So sum of c2 to c10, this is summation y. Then sum of d2 to d10, summation x square. And in the end, sum of e2 to e10, this is summation xy. So I'm going to calculate alpha hat. I'm denoting it here, typing as a hat. Actually, it is alpha hat. So I'm going to calculate numerator of a hat first. So Look at the numerator formula, it is summation x square. So this value is summation x square in D11 times summation y, here in this formula summation y is in C11 minus summation x. So minus summation x, it means minus B11 times summation xy. So steric summation xy is this value. So that's it. This is how you can calculate numerator. So next, calculate denominator of A hat. You can calculate both numerator and denominator, or in other words, you can calculate this formula in one cell as well. But in order to explain it clearly, I am going to calculate numerator and denominator separately. So denominator is n, which is the number of observations. So number of observations are 9. So n is, just put equal sign, n is 9 times summation x square, which is 1308, located in D11, minus summation x whole square, which is B11 whole square. Press enter, and A hat is actually numerator our denominator. So I'm going to increase the width. So numerator is 2010 divided by denominator 1368. So this is the calculated value of A hat, which is 1.469298. Similarly, in order to calculate beta hat, so first calculate numerator of beta hat. I'm using B hat instead of beta hat, and then denominator of beta hat, DEN mean denominator. So numerator is n, which is 9 times summation xy, which is 11, minus summation x, which is B11 times summation xy, summation y. So I'm reading this formula, summation y is C11. That's it. Press enter, and then denominator is, you can see that both have same formula, denominator of alpha hat as well as denominator of beta hat. So you can copy from the same value from this point as well. So it is G9. So in the end, B hat is numerator over denominator. So in order to calculate beta hat, just divide this numerator by denominator. So it is 2.83. So in the end, we can write it as fitted regression line is, this is also called least square regression line. So it is y hat is equal to alpha hat plus beta hat times x. So y hat is equal to alpha hat, which is 1.46. so I'm just considering rounding it off, 1.47, rounding to two digits, plus beta, which is 2.83 times x. So this is fitted regression line. So this is our least square regression line, or fitted regression line. So that's it. So you can also use the alternative formula for calculating beta hat, which is summation x minus x bar into y minus y bar whole over summation x minus x bar square. And similarly, you can calculate alpha hat using this alternative formula as well. So this is all about estimating the value of alpha hat and beta hat using least square regression model. So let us review the main concepts which we have discussed in today's lecture. In this lecture, we have discussed the simple linear regression model, and then we discussed the method of ordinary least square, and then properties of OLS method, and in the end, we discussed standard error of regression and coefficient of determination. So in the next lecture, we will do one comprehensive example in order to explain the OLS estimates and standard error of regression and the coefficient of determinations. We will also interpret the output produced by simple linear regression model. And then we will discuss multiple linear regression model as well, and we will do the estimation and interpretations, and the related examples will be discussed. So till then, Allah Hafiz.